we're live. So now, with the you've got to understand when you're struggling with when you're struggling with ruminating thoughts. Thank you. When you're struggling, fun.
Makeup girl.
Okay. Okay. I forgot to put my makeup on this time. As a joke. It'll probably look at something. Okay. Oh yeah. Okay. So you've got to remember, like, you know, ruminating thoughts, like thoughts going on and on and on without thoughts going on and on and on. And you can't stop the thinking.
Don't stop,
because
you kept going.
Okay. I think they enjoy it. I think they enjoy it.
I do, yeah. Listening to laughter videos from 2015.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it's not perfect. But anyway. Okay, so you've got to understand, you know, with ruminating thought. I mean, it's quite understandable. Even advanced people can get a bout of ruminating thoughts. But you have to understand where you are in your spiritual journey as to why you're prone, and whether you've had a recent trauma as well, which can be a major factor. But remember, if someone hasn't done much spiritual work and they're prone to things like addiction or distraction, then they'll have a very, very big inflated ego, which will mean that the more repressed feelings you've got, the more repressed... So what are the main repressed feelings? Like shame, guilt, fear, anger. So by constantly using on Netflix, on donuts, on whatever it is, relationship addiction, whatever it is, you've got like a huge cylinders of repressed feelings. So this in itself will set your level of consciousness. So people who haven't done much spiritual work will generally be, you know, they'll be plodding through life, but they will be thinking quite a lot. And they will have, you know, quite a lot of negativity going on. But if a trauma happens or something very difficult happens, then, you know, they can get like very severe ruminations, very, very severe obsessive thinking, or even morbid thinking going on. Also, when these repressed feelings come up, what happens is the ego will project out into the world that a solution needs to be fixed for it to feel secure. So it's like, you know, like it could be like somebody dies and then suddenly you're worried because the sink's blocked. You know, it's like, oh, if only I could fix the sink and get the plumber to fix the sink properly, then I'll be okay. And it's like, actually, that's not really what the problem's about. But it becomes like, you know, really what's happened is one is at a reasonably low level of consciousness, but then something blows up, and then it's like when something blows up, you know, a death or a financial loss or whatever it is, then the ego looks for something to fix, often as a distraction from the doing a lot of inner work. So it fixates on trying to control an external scenario, and thinks that if that external scenario is fixed, then everything would be okay. Sometimes the scenario might be about what it is, but, you know, it may even be about something totally irrelevant. You know, it might be like, you know, so that can happen. So when the ego, now the thing is, when you get things not going your way, it's like it opens up even more of those trapped feelings. It opens up a huge door and these repressed feelings come out. And then the ego gets very, very agitated. And when a lot of feelings are coming out, then automatically they're correlated. Extreme feelings means obsessive thinking. They go together. Mm-hmm. So as soon as you release the pressure valve of the repressed feelings, then the thinker will start to slow down. And as you escalate up the wave bands of the levels of consciousness, you'll start to see things more serene. You'll also start to see situations differently. Like people who are doing spiritual work might see, like, for example, oh, this person's been very, very bad and they've done me wrong. But as you do the spiritual work, feel the feelings, forgiveness, letting go, cancelling beliefs, suddenly you start to see a more benign picture, like, well, maybe they were sick, or maybe they were doing the best they could. So you start to see the world through different filters. Also, you start to see things more clearly. Now, the way I deal with things is, you know, the most important thing is, like, if I've got a lot of feelings, a lot of obsessive, ruminating thinking going on, I always think that, yeah, I mean, if you have to, if there's emergent things you need to fix or do, or the next right things, then do those. But that's not the priority. You know, the priority is actually releasing all the repressed feelings and going up in the levels of consciousness. Also remember, like, when you're in a lot of obsessive thinking or ruminating thinking, and there's lots of repressed emotions like fear or anxiety or grief coming up, then that and all the negative thinking is tying you to a very low level of consciousness. It's like a low vibration. If when you're in low vibrations and a lot of thinking, you tend to, situations in your life tend to stay stuck or get worse because you're vibrating at a low level of consciousness. So all that fear or grief, all of that stuff, even if you have situations to fix, they'll tend to be, you'll try and fix them, but they'll still tend to be messy as you're trying to fix them. They won't resolve very easily. So the main thing is, for me, is like, I need to tune up to a higher vibration. So how do I do that? Well, you know, if you're in a 12-step group, the 12 steps, all of the aspects of the 12 steps will help you to tune up to a higher vibration, prayer, meditation, step 10s, attending meetings and doing service. But also for me, one of the core things is just sitting with the feelings. And because as you sit with those feelings, like all these feelings are exploding up because of a situation. As you're feeling those feelings, it's like you're tuning up your vibration. You're going to higher levels of serenity or peace or acceptance. You're going out of terror or fear or grief into more positive vibrations. This automatically will attract solutions to your problems. Like, you know, you're thinking, I need to fix the sink, or I need to, you know, clean the garden, or whatever it is, then magnetically, as you release those feelings, you'll be intuitively guided, or synchronicities will happen that will clear out the problems. So, now one of the things is, like, if I was to have, like, a lot of ruminating thinking or negative thinking, one of the things that I've said, which I know because I've studied the work of Dr. David Hawkins, is when I've got a lot of repressed, like, fear or anxiety or any negative emotion, my mother died less than a year ago, that actually went relatively quickly because I was quite, I practiced the field of feelings for such a long time that I was able to ride, when you practice feeling the feelings, you're able to ride very extreme feelings without trying to distract. So that you're able to get through very difficult situations very quickly, where other people would take a lot longer. Like, I remember as well, because I'd done this with extreme pain, like with a kidney operation. After the general anesthetic, I didn't take any morphine or anything. I just felt the pain 100% without any band-aids. So then, you know, the surgeon said, like, oh, you made a very fast and good recovery. Also, after the grief, I was able to, after the death of my mother, just by being with, when the huge waves of feelings came up, you know, I was with them 100%, and I rode those waves as they came up and then released, and rode the waves as they come and released. That for me then tunes you up to a higher vibration. With problems, like if you've got practical problems that you need to solve, apart from doing, you know, for me it's like, I will try and fix them, but I'll keep that to a minimum. You know, just do the next right thing. But really for me, solutions get more resolved more effectively if my vibration goes up and I'm clearing out the negativity. Because if I've got a problem to fix, I'm in a lot of fear and a lot of obsessive thinking. It might get fixed, but more often it gets more unmanageable. You know, it's like if I'm angry at somebody and I have to, like, speak to them, if I don't clear up my anger and my fear, and I try and clear it up from that vibration, you know, it often is a messy cleanup, you see. So if I resolve the emotions in me first, so I'm feeling more serene and resolved, and then try and communicate or resolve or speak to the plumber or speak to a manager, then it tends to clean up in a more effective manner than going in without resolving the stuff. If you have to, you have to. But I always know that if I try and solve a situation from a higher vibration, the outcome is better. Or if I had it like a bad neighbor, that I had to deal with. If I've got a lot of unresolved feelings towards that neighbor and I try and communicate with them, then often in my experience, it'll go badly. Even if what I'm saying is sane and good, because I've got so much like repressed anger and repressed fear that I haven't dealt with. Even the way I write, the way I communicate, even if the words are okay, somehow the neighbor responds in a bad way. Whereas if I can wait as long as possible and forgive and pray and feel my feelings and do that, and then go at the last minute, having cleared up much of my inner state as possible, and then I speak to the neighbor, then often it will go in a far more better way. So more influential, rather than the practical, is my vibration in dealing with problems than actually immediately jumping in when I have got a really messy vibration on the inside. The other thing I would say around rumination and negative and obsessive thinking is if I've got a lot of negative thinking or chatter or ruminating or obsessive thinking or unhelpful thinking going on, is I always say to myself that, you know, my thinking is a correlation of what wave band of emotion I'm tuned into. So when I'm on a lot of fear, then I'm tuned into radio fear. Or if I'm in anger, I'm tuned into radio anger. Those are very low vibrations. You know, if I'm in fear, I'm going to get a lot of fearful thoughts. If I'm in anger, I'm going to get a lot of angry thoughts. So sometimes when I'm in a low vibration, I will just say to myself, all my thoughts are useless. They're all meaningless. There's no point in me coming up with creative solutions when I'm in a bad vibration. So I'll just put on a spiritual speaker or feel my feelings or do spiritual practices until I feel more tuned into a higher vibration. And then, you know, the thoughts that come in at a higher vibration are the ones I'll act on. And, you know, like if there's a problem, I'm in lots of in fear or anger, I usually won't bother trying to come up with a solution because I know it's coming out of that energy field of fear or anger. Does that make sense? So, you know, it's like when I'm tuned into an insane vibration, I just accept all my thinking for creative solutions will be insane. So I don't bother listening, you know, like I'm not going to bother listening to this. I'll put on a spiritual speaker or feel my feelings or do spirit until I feel tuned in, and then I'll see what's coming through when I'm tuned in. So really, that's what I would say with ruminating thoughts. But as you release your feelings, you know, you'll get less thoughts and your thoughts will be more intuitive and you'll pull in more creative solutions. If you're dealing with people, you know, praying for them, using the Course in Miracles, praying for a miracle to see them differently. God is the love in which I bless them. God is the love in which I forgive them. Instead of this person, I could see peace. Instead of the situation, I could see peace. So using all of the Course in Miracles exercise, sitting with the feelings, being in the witnesser or the observer while these thoughts go on. If you're adept at using the observer practice, then if there's a lot of thinking going on, you just keep, either you play a video of someone who's, you know, like I've got videos called the Observer Tool on YouTube. If you get that, like what's observing the constant thinking? And that if you just listen to a video while that's going on, you try and be in the observer of the thinking rather than being in the thinking. So just like if you're in a cinema hall and the cinema's on, if you go into hypnosis, you believe that the cinema is real. Yeah. So when you're in obsessive thinking, you're identified with your thinking as being real. So then you ride the roller coaster as if your thinking is the real thing. But if you remember, you know, like it'd be like watching a horror movie in a cinema, and then you actually believe that the monsters are real. But if you suddenly realize that there's a projector there, and if you go to be in the place of the projector rather than be on the movie screen, then suddenly it takes the power out of the movie. Does that make sense? So when there's like a obsessive thinking, you can't think your way out of obsessive thinking because you have to go to another level to get out of the thinking. So what's observing the thinking? What's witnessing the thinking? Being the witness of the thinking rather than being in the thinking, trying to get out of the thinking. So that's another way of focusing on the observer. So when you start to, even me talking about the observer will take you out of realizing that being identified with your thoughts is the problem. So you need to detach from identifying with your thoughts and be in the detached observer of your thoughts. Then the thoughts start to lose their power to grip you. you see. Mm-hmm. So that's the other thing. So
it's really interesting because it ties in almost with what we spoke about last week.
Yes.
And that is that when I spoke about the use of antidepressants, you say that they're used as well to arrest that low-level vibration of yes. obsessive thinking.
Yes.
So therefore, when I went on them, they stopped that,
yes.
which is ruminating thoughts,
yes.
etc. They cut that off, so you're not feeling that low-level vibration.
Yes.
Then another interesting thing happened. I've got a friend, and she's had an issue with a child of hers. He keeps getting intrusive thoughts. He's only very, very young.
Yes.
Very small. And it was really interesting. Something happened to me. You know how we say, well, we are not our thoughts, we can do observer tool, etc. And I'm just thinking, but some of them seem so real to me that I sort of identify with them. Sometimes it's very difficult to use that, you know, tool and separate yourself.
Yes.
Until a really insane thing happened to me. I went to this appointment and they had gates that the receptionist had to open for you to go in, you know, like a security gate that you have in a company.
Yeah.
And for 1 second, I thought to myself, I was in very contemplative mood and I didn't want to speak to anyone. And for 1 second, I thought, would it be great if I was just a superwoman and I could just do that and fly over the gate? And I realized the insanity of the thoughts. And I was like, well, you're not, so you need to go and ask to be let in. And I just think, but this is the same. I can see that as ridiculous.
Yes.
But I can equally have same thoughts the maker would say, oh, they're very relevant, but they're equally insane.
Yes, yeah. Hence, yeah. you know, I like the Course yeah. in Miracles, which is all my thoughts are meaningless, the very first lines. Because the problem is, by saying all my thoughts are meaningless, it means, because the ego is cunning, baffling and powerful, meaning that if you say that 99% of my thoughts are meaningless, then you'll be still interested in your thoughts. Mm. Like when you're in the observer, like no thought is interesting, but when you believe your thinking is useful, then you have identification or interest, because it's like we're talking about the supervisor in some of our talks. It's like some part of your ego is still waiting for the next interesting thought or the next special thought. So if we were to say like 99% of your thoughts are meaningless, but every now and then there's a special thought that you should wait for in case you get it, then you still be in the trap of thing. And also, when you get into the practice of the observer, all that pulls you out of being in the states of flow and the observer is an interesting thought. That's all it is. But, you know, and you get caught out. Or an interesting thought, or an interesting object, or an interesting person. So all of those things pull you out. So actually, in the world, there is nothing that's special. There is no such thing as a special thought. There is no such thing as a special person. There is no such thing as a special job. There is no such thing as special weather. Then nothing pulls you out of being in the observer state. So that's hence letting go. I mean, in 12-step languaging, we'd say that you can't make anything in this world your higher power. If you make anything in this world your higher power, it's like you'll have a really good, peaceful day until your higher power comes along. And then it'll take you out. You see, so if your boss is your higher power, like you'll be fine until you meet your boss, or if your wages are your higher power, you know, you'll be fine until your wages are affected, or if your mother's your higher power, you'll be fine until your mother dies, you see, or you know, so it's all of those things.
This correlates, sorry to interrupt you again, this correlates with Dr. Hawkins, who I've listened to a 5-minute video on fear this morning.
Yes.
And he talks about the ego tells you that you need that XYZ thing to be okay.
Yes.
And if that's taken away from you, including mom or a child or a job or wages, your ego tells you we're not okay anymore. We're not okay anymore. So we need that to be okay. That's what ego tells you, the illusion of it. Mm.
That's true. And that's what the Course in Miracles says, you know, your external gods. So you believe, you know, there's lesson, some of my favorite lessons, I think it's 107. You know, it says you think without money, you won't be okay. Or you think without that special partner in your bed, you won't be okay. Or you think without whatever it is. But actually, they're all illusions. None of those things are based on, you think you need special pills to pop in for your health. Now, I mean, I'm not saying they're good, but at the highest level of consciousness, those are still bondages to you recognizing your highest level of truth. You know, they would be called magical projections, which is fine, but it does stop you from reaching the highest levels of enlightenment. Yeah.
Can I ask, when does the peace come in that? Because I can understand that and accept that, and as I think as part of my spiritual journey, I totally accept that. I can see I'm making something outside of me, my higher power, and that cuts me off from God,
that's right,
from the source. But I don't have any peace from that. Knowing that. That's not giving me any peace.
No. Well, this whole group is about how to let go of special projections. So if you cancel your belief in something, I cancel my belief that my boss is my higher power. Mm. I'm an infinite being. So that will take it out. Even the lessons in A Course in Miracles, you know, you can have a photo of your boss, put it on the table, and then you say, my boss is equally as meaningless as the mug of tea. Look at the tea for a second, which is as meaningless as the plant, so which is as meaningless as the pot of tea, which is as meaningless as the teddy bear. So you give each thing 1 second of attention as you look around and say each is meaningless. So eventually your boss becomes as equally meaningless as a mug of tea, as a plant, or as a teddy bear. So you're actually, those are practical exercises to dismantle your ego's projection. You know, like in addiction, you look at something and you sort of, you glaze at it. Mm. And you give it like I'm a food addict, so if there would be donuts on the table, I'd be like staring at the donuts, you know, as the most exciting object in the whole room. And after a meeting, you'd say like, well, how was the meeting? And so there was a plate of donuts on the table. And what else happened? There wasn't anything else that happened. You know, that was it.
So, life stopped.
So the course that's very practical. Mm. Look at the donuts, it's meaningless. Then look at the mug of tea, it's meaningless. So yes, that's not intellectual, that's stripping the ego of the projection. Or I cancel my belief is an invocation to grace, to the Holy Spirit. Mm. Take away my projection that donuts or my manager or whatever it is, or my wages, or my career, or whatever has that is the source. You know, so that's asking God, remove that as my higher. It's not. You know, God is my source. I'm an infinite being. My nature is infinite, limitless, eternal, and not limited to being trapped into obsessing about some externalized projection as being special. Also, when you make something special and you look at it and everything, you get a lot of pent-up feelings around it. And that's the attachment. So you get a dependency on what you project as a higher power. So when you do the feel the feelings, like if I had, there's some donuts on the table, the donuts could be a manager, it could be a career, or it could be the death of a loved one, it doesn't matter, that's symbolic. But if I put it on the table and then it brings up those feelings, and then I let go of my thoughts and just keep feeling out the repressed feelings, then eventually I'll get into a place of neutrality around that. You know, I'll empty out all the grief, or I'll empty out all the fear or all the projections of specialness, just empty out that vibration of attachment, you see, and then that will empty it out. So eventually I'll be in a place of neutrality around it. So that will dismantle the higher power status that's been projected. So you have to do spiritual work around it. Yeah. Also, I just wanted to quickly share, what if you're one of those people who find it very difficult to access your feelings around situations? Now, if you're in a job or whatever, and all kinds of things are happening and defects are coming up, and you're frustrated and you're going into beating yourself up, I was irritable then, or I wasn't my best self. First of all, there's a few things. If you find it difficult to access your feelings, one thing to realize is with feeling the feelings, you can have states like feeling frozen or feeling disconnected. Or feeling, which means it feels like you can't connect to deeper feelings, but you also realize that's a vibration, or that's an energy. So you can sit with your feelings of feeling frozen or unable to connect with your deeper feelings. Does that make sense? Mm. So however you are, if you stop labeling it and stop going into your thinking, and just let it be, like even the state of numbness or frozenness you can sit that out, you can feel that out, you know, and once you thaw that first level out, then the next layers will start to come out. So some people are like, you know, if you say like feel your feelings or be with your emotions or be with your vibration, they say, well, I can't. But that's because they've got a layer of like a layer of frozenness or blankness or something or disconnectedness or detachment. So you just be with that. When you're with something, anything, it starts to dissolve. But when you're in your thinking and distracting away from it, or putting Netflix on or eating donuts, you don't get to be with that, with these more subtle, difficult things to be with. Does that make sense?
Mm.
Because, you know, like being with a sense of frozenness is difficult to articulate. Mm. You'd be like, oh, well, I can't feel my feelings, so I won't bother. But you can just be with those. So,